Hi friends, in this current session under electrostatics, we will try to learn something called equipotential surfaces. Let me explain with the help of a diagram. Let us say there is in space, we kept a positive charge here. Naturally surrounding it, you find its space or region or what you call as field. Now you may be wondering how it is spherical, why it should be spherical. I will come to the answer that why it should be spherical a little bit later. Let us see, the field is spread like this and the field lines will be going like this. These are all electric field lines. This is how field is spread across a positive charge kept at a point. Now in this surface, wherever you take on the surface, at every point on this surface, if the potential is same everywhere, then we can say this is an equipotential surface. Means the so-called electric potential at every point of the surface, if it is found to be same, then it is supposed to be called as equipotential surface. To understand further about this, let us recollect the definition. We already studied that as per definition, suppose two points are lying down, if A and B lie on equipotential surface, then automatically the potential of A should be equal to potential of B. Both should have the same potential. Therefore, when you calculate the work done, which is nothing but the difference of these two, that is found to be zero. That means no work is done. No work is done for what? For doing this work. What is this work? This work is for moving a test charge from one point of the equipotential surface to the other. So, no work is done in moving a test charge from one point of equipotential surface to the other. That is, you are not doing any work on an equipotential surface because potential is same everywhere. So with this background, we will try to understand further. For instance, let us suppose a unit positive charge is carried through a small distance. Through a small distance, let us say dl, over the equipotential surface which is under conservation. Now there is a field, electric field E. Because of this, some electric field is created. Wherever you take, you find electric field. So we let us suppose that a small charge is being carried away, carried to some distance dl. So there is a field, there is means force is there, there is some distance I am considering, naturally work done will be there. So work done is nothing but energy. So therefore, small amount of movement, therefore small work done you can calculate as scalar product of this. The scalar product means magnitude of electric field and cosine of the other component in dl cos theta. That is actually found to be zero. Just now we calculated our equipotential surface, work done is zero. So edl cos theta zero means cos theta is equal to zero. That implies theta equal to 90. Theta equal to 90 means your field is perpendicular to the distance. That means the so-called field intensity, that is E, the field intensity is always acting perpendicular, that is normal to the equipotential surface. So this is a competitive question. How can you say that the electric field intensity is always normal to an equipotential surface? This is how we can prove it. So now in this situation, for any charge configuration, when I say configuration, I am taking distribution of charge, continuous charge, number of charges. For any charge configuration, equipotential surface through a point is normal to the electric field at that point. So wherever you take, the field always will be normal. That is what we have to understand. We kept a single charge. Therefore, for a single charge Q, what is the potential? Potential V is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Now if you see the right hand term terms, charge you are not changing in the middle of the process. So charge is constant, 4 is a number, pi is a constant, epsilon is a constant. The only thing that is variable is R. That means from this you can say, if R is constant, V is constant. That means V can be constant only if R is constant. That implies, you can infer from this that equipotential surfaces of a single point charge are concentric spherical surfaces centered around at the charge. Now I'll again explain. For a single charge, this is a potential equation where Q is constant, 4 pi epsilon is constant, so there is a relation between V's and R as V is inversely proportional to R. So V can be constant only when R can be constant. That concept if you try to apply here, for a single charge when you take on an equipotential surface, so everywhere it is constant, so the field line distance will always be, R will be constant. R is constant means the locus if you take around the charge, you will get the ultimate picture as a sphere. That's why you find equipotential generally supposed to be spherical in nature in the case of a single point charge. So wherever you take, R is constant. This side, this side, this side, this side, this side. Everywhere R is constant. Therefore potential is constant means R is constant. Suppose you take the distance R. Here it is R, here it is R, R, everywhere it is R is constant. Therefore, V is constant. Now you try to draw, connecting all these points, the locus you will get is nothing but sphere. So you will find concentric spheres in the case of a single point charge centered around the main charge. Right? This is about why you find concentric circles here. Let us look at other cases. For example, you take uniform electric field, say along x-axis. The equipotential surfaces are planes normal to x-axis. That means planes parallel to yz plane. For example, when the field is uniform, you can take like this. Wherever you take, the fields will be like this. When the field is uniform, this is how the diagram looks like. Not spherical in this case. Right? Suppose you take another case, electric dipole. You take an electric dipole. So how the equipotential surfaces looks like? They are like this. Dipole means when I take, there is a negative charge, there is some positive charge. Like a single charge, you find like that. Dipole surfaces. In equipotential, on equipotential surfaces, when you keep a dipole, this is how field lines look like. Suppose you take identical positive charges, then how the equipotential surface looks like this. Let us say I have taken a positive charge here, I have taken another positive charge here. Now these two will repel, so the fields will be trying to spread across and repelling each other. So therefore, the field will be like this. Here also, like this. That means the overlap could be like that. This is in the case of identical positive charges when taken on a equipotential surfaces. So if you carefully observe all these things, this is on due to identical positive charges, this is due to dipole, this is due to uniform electric field in a plane along x-axis. If you see all these diagrams, what it gives, now this gives, or these drawings, you can say, these drawings give us alternative visual pictures of electric field around a charge configuration. Without field lines also you can draw field, how field is spread, you can display it. So this is how things you have to understand as far as equipotential surface is concerned. Well, with the help of equipotential surface, with that background, we will try to understand something very important in electrostatics known as flux. But before going to understanding flux, let me explain something else called area vector. It's very interesting because you know area is a scalar. Now why we are saying area vector? Because the important thing is in complicated problem solving, it is convenient to treat area as a vector. You should have scalar, you better consider as a vector, then problems can easily be addressed. So important thing is therefore how to associate a vector to area of a, let us say, curved surface. How to do that? Now, first thing we do is, suppose there is an area given to you, given area. Now, you have to divide this given area, closed area. Divide this given area into number of very small area elements. Let us say I have been given an area like this. Now this I will treat it as number of elements. Total area is divided into very small area. Now in this, each small area element you are taking, it is to be treated as a planar. Each one is taken as a plane. Why you are treating as a plane? Because the so-called normal to the plane, it tells us or specifies orientation of the plane. Orientation of the plane means direction of the plane or planar area. Because it is showing direction, automatically it becomes vector. It is along normal. So you are able to find out how or in which particular direction the field is acting. So apart from magnitude, you also got direction. Hence you can use the term vector. But the problem is, when you say a normal, this normal can point in two directions. Normal can be in two directions. Either it can be inwards or it can be outwards. So therefore, we follow the convention. What is the convention telling us? By convention, a vector associated with every area element of a closed surface is taken to be in the direction of outward normal. That means we always consider by convention outward direction. So therefore, with this background, Let us say, I have a surface, a small area element. Let us say its area is delta S. But the normal is always in this direction. The field will be in this direction, n cap. Suppose you take another diagram, such type of a surface. In this surface, you are considering a small area element. This area is delta S. Now, its normal will be in this direction. So, that means whatever area element you are considering as a vector represented as a delta S, where it is at a point and n cap is nothing but the unit vector, is a unit vector in the direction of outward normal drawn at that point. Now you can calculate delta S as n cap delta S. What does this mean? This is a vector. This is showing direction. This is showing magnitude. So the product of magnitude and direction always gives a vector, na? In that context, we have written like this. So here and here, if you take, here the delta S is n cap delta S. Here the delta S will be n cap delta S. So the best thing is, when, what is the conclusion of this idea? Suppose you have a very bigger surface where you have to calculate potential field, etc. So don't worry about like this, though it is regular or irregular. Just divide this entire surface into small area elements and take each area element and find the unit vector. Product always gives you vector potential. Automatically you will get an area in terms here treated as a vector. So by considering as a vector, you will find some solutions for some of the problems involving directions. That is the basic idea of this discussion. Now, with this background, we shall try to understand something called electric flux. To understand electric flux, we have to have the basic knowledge of area vector, because we may use the word area vector in the discussion. So at that time, you should have a clarity on what is area vector. So I hope you are clear about what is basically area vector is all is going to be. Right? That is nothing but treating area instead of a scalar, we are treating as a vector. So that helps us to solve some of the problems, especially numericals when we are trying to solve. We'll get an idea about what basically area vector is all going to be. So with the concept of electrostatic, with the concept of equipotential surface and area vector, in the next session we shall try to understand electric flux. Okay, kindly go through this and get back if you have any doubts to get clarity on that.